The title of the panel is Societal Impacts of Big Data and the Role of Civil Society. As you know, there's no day that goes by without speaking of big data. It's something that is still quite elusive and worrisome and a big opportunity. We still don't know how to handle it. Still, many researchers have started to work on the topics. Many institutions have started to study the issues and proposing opinion and regulations or sketching a potential way of framing big data. Today we will try to dig a little bit more into that. First of all, I would like to thank you, Hans, for putting the panel together. This is part also of a European project, but I'm sure that Hans will tell us a little bit more. The rules of the game are as follows. Hans will have a couple of 12-15 minutes maximum to set the stage and provide some basic input, and the three speakers will rejoin and discuss based on that. I will ask each speaker to introduce herself or himself by situating herself, himself, and her or his institution within the debate, so that we can better grasp what the speaking point of each of them. So let's start. Hans, please.
Okay, I'm Hans Lammerand. I work at Brussels University. But on the specific research project of BITE. BITE looks at the social, the official word is externalities, but understand it as impacts of the societal impacts of big data. So not the purely technical thing, but what comes with when you implement big data in all sorts of practices, what sort of legal, social, economical consequences and impacts does it have? So first it was more or less looking at in terms of case studies and trying to see what are the impacts and how do we have to deal with it. That's a research phase. And now we're more in the last phase of the project, which is a bit trying to do some community building to get more stakeholders involved also in the European policy debate. At this moment, it's mostly, let's say, technical and academic community, and the idea is we need to get more of the civil society players or other stakeholders which are in a way having to deal with all the societal consequences of big data to get them as well in the debate to influence things like research agenda and other elements connected with big data policy. In that sense, I'm going to present now a bit sort of research findings, but I may not forget the last administrative bit. Because we are an EU-funded project, I also need a presence list. I know this is a privacy camp, so I'm not really going to check if everyone has signed, but it would be nice if I have a collection of names and so on. So I'm going to give it to you and I'll do it there. If you really don't want to be on,
And remember that we live in a post-truth environment, so there is no obligation to be accurate.
Yeah, but don't put things which are obvious don't make sense of, because then I get also too much. It's not going to be published anywhere. It's part of the internal administrative requirements. But okay, back to the subject. So I will present a bit like what we had a sort of research findings on big data, not a whole bit, but some few points which I think are important when it comes to how can civil society get involved. If we look to big data, what sort of consequences it had from the case studies to find sort of common framework, it was interesting to look at the sort of interactions between different actors and how does it change the moment you have to do with big data. With interactions can be commercial transactions, can be different actors in more an industry setting, or can be consumers and producers and that sort of interactions. One element we noticed is what big data enables is to deal with a lot more actors, data and interactions while reducing the transaction costs. So that makes that one of the typical elements is that the amount of transactions become much higher between different actors, and it also means that the visibility, at least from the one where the data comes from, becomes much higher to the other actors. that puts under pressure a lot of legal systems. Another element we noticed is, in fact, those legal frameworks are, let's say, the sort of gatekeeping tools people, be it organizations, be it individuals, have to deal with their privacy, what gets seen, what doesn't get seen. Normally, the old way you think the walls of your house, that's your private environment, but the moment you start using these things, everything starts leaking out, and those typical boundaries, they get penetrated the whole time. That's where that whole idea of much higher interactions, much higher visibility comes from. So you need new ways to do the gatekeeping, to deal with your capacity to guard your own autonomy in action, and doesn't that you don't get completely lose all autonomy in handling. Another element which was important to notice was that data is becoming a network good. The idea of network goods, that comes from a time when we had, let's say, faxes and telephones and so on. And the idea there is that when you have a new fax owner, whatever, introduced in, let's say, the network, is that the value for all others becomes higher. It's a bit different from the typical good, where the more you produce, you get sort of a limit where it's still useful. With the sort of positive networks, in fact, the more things that are available get produced, the more value for everyone. That's something that's known from the, let's say, the old communication tools, but we notice it's also valid for data. The more data can get linked, the more it can be used for different purposes. And that's one of the drivers for all those privacy intrusive business models. The more data gets collected, the more uses it can get, the more value can get extracted. So that's a consequence of the big data as and the underlying network technologies of making it possible to link data in a lot of ways and to get data out of the silos. The next element that was became clear is that it's not just big data, but it's more a general observation which gets in a way strengthened by big data, is that you have a shift from typical commercial transactions, which are in a way one-off transactions where you have, at the moment you buy a good, there's a little bit of information exchanging. You pay a certain price, and the only way you have to deal with the one who sold your good afterwards is maybe when there's a problem and you have to apply the guarantees. Now when you buy goods, often you also buy services. There's a continuous interaction from these things. When you now buy a computer with Windows 10 on, there's a continuous flow of information going to Windows, and you get that with a lot of tools. We also see that evolution in industry, and where it was an interesting finding to see that the sort of privacy problems that creates is also happening in a purely business-to-business context. One of the research case studies was oil and gas sector, and there you have the same problem with big data making, because that put sensors in all sorts of tools, is that the big producers have a problem with too much of their valuable information becomes visible to a lot of suppliers. So it's not just a consumer thing, you see that showing up in a lot of contexts. Now those elements, you see that has an impact, of course, on data protection. Data protection being one of our important legal frameworks, how we as individuals can do the gatekeeping to all sorts of other actors which have information about us. You have a lot of industry making noise about data protection being too difficult to deal with. Now, one of the things is that from our research, it's not so an impossible framework. There are possibilities to do to implement big data in a more risk-based approach. On the other hand, we also see that in the legal framework, there are some elements which indeed give problems in that context of much higher interactions. One of the reasons is that a lot of mechanisms are still based on that old transaction model. The typical example is consent, which from the moment you have to give a sort of permission each time with a transaction, that generates a lot of transaction costs. In a way, it artificially reintroduces transaction costs where big data enables to go a lot faster in a lot of things. You have that also in other contexts, like in intellectual property rights. The fact that a writer or right holder has to give permission is also one of the elements blocking a lot of big data practices. Why everyone uses Twitter to monitor a lot of things is because Twitter gives a license to get to access to that information, and a lot of other contexts you see it gets blocked. So you have that in several legal frameworks that you notice that old administrative control mechanisms don't function very well in a big data context because they just don't scale. One of the ways to bring in again a sort of protection which functions in a big data context is to look for more aggregated mechanisms of control or more collective ones. In fact, in the intellectual property context, you already have that in certain ways with collective management organizations. But in the privacy context, one of an important actor to do that sort of more aggregated control are the data protection authorities. But in that sense, as a regulator, they can push for more sort of collective standards, collective measures, which in a way take away also the responsibility for an individual consumer to check each time and get harassed by that duty. Like I think in this, when you look to the cookies, you always have to click away before you can access a website. That's clearly a dysfunctional protection mechanism. It's meant for protection, but in practice it's harassing the different parties, both the one offering the website as the one using it. So it's looking for that sort of more aggregated ways to build in a protection again. One of the interesting elements in the data protection regulation there is the notion of privacy by design, which is in a way a method to move a lot of that decision making to the design phase. So it's a way of that aggregated control. The moment you in the design phase try to make the most important decisions and come also to a sort of standardized way of acting, you have in the moment you choose a product, a service or whatever, you have much more less information, you need less information to be able to do that judging. That moves a lot of responsibility to that designing and so on. And we see that over the last 10 years there's been put quite some effort in developing things like privacy by design, going from very basic principles to measurable notions of anonymity and so on, and developing design methods around it. The important element, and then I come to the last element, what's the role of civil society there? When we talk, civil society has a lot of impact on, or a lot of voice in the discussion on the big legal frameworks, but when you put in those big legal frameworks quite open notion like privacy by design, and it's important to put it in there as a notion to develop, it's also important that civil society doesn't disappear in the further development what that notion means. So for me that's a bit of the question which I also want to give to the other speakers, like how can civil society or other stakeholders stay involved in that development of what does something like privacy by design means. It's important that it doesn't is left to a technical community to invent that, or to the commercial sector to say what's your privacy by design going to be, but that civil society takes a bit of control in that development as well.
Okay, thank you very much, Hans. Thank you for taking the time too. I'll shift the floor to Christiane. You have probably a specific perspective on this.
I work for the European Data Protection Supervisor, and for those of you not familiar with our organisation. We're an EU institution, very small one, about 50 or 60 people, and we do a lot of policy work, and obviously we're now talking about policy, but our main role is the same as other data protection authorities, which is to supervise how personal information is processed, and to enforce the rules which apply to European Union bodies and institutions. There are about 70 of them. So we do to them what DPAs do with data controllers around Europe, in the private sector and public sector. And this is an excellent topic. And I listened with great interest to Hans, because this, we have been working a lot in this area in the last few years. The data protection supervisor Giovanni Buttarelli has given a number of speeches and published a number of opinions on big data and its different ramifications and how the EU should be responding collectively to those challenges. And you can find that on our website. There's a page called Big Data and the Digital Clearinghouse, which I'll come on to a bit later, where you can find our output on this. Kirsten asked me if I had any slides, and I said no, but that was a lie. I actually have one slide, but I can't display it. It's just there. But it's actually I think it's a graphic that we developed a couple of years ago, which illustrates largely what Hans was saying, that when we're talking about, we call this the big data ecosystem, which is just a load of marketing, blah, blah, blah. But what we're trying to explain is that it's not simply about rules and regulations and enforcement. It's also a question of accountability of companies and of governments and public sector organizations who are processing information, and that gets you into ethical domain. It's also about, as Hans has said, the design phase and how products, digital products, are engineered, designed and engineered, and even before they get to market, and that they should be conscious of privacy and of other freedoms, fundamental freedoms. And fourthly, which was perhaps less evident in what Hans was saying, about empowered individuals and that people need to feel able to take control over what's happening with their own the data which concerns them and their lives online. So I'll try and elaborate on that in the next few minutes. I'll just speak briefly about big data and what we understand is going on out there before I talk about the EU legal framework, particularly the Charter of Fundamental Rights, something on what we're doing and what we think what we're pressing the EU to do, the different institutions, and then finally some suggestions of how civil society can help even more. And they've already been pushing the debate in very helpful directions. So there's not much to say about what big data is. It's a marketing term. It's like saying Brexit means Brexit. You need to interrogate what practices lie behind that term, rather than the hype around it. In fact, according to Luciano Foridi, who is one of the members of the ethical advisory group which the EDPS set up a year ago, big data is a problem of epistemology. In other words, how do we know that what we think we know is true? The reality is that big data, or data these days, is like exhaust fumes. It's everywhere, and there is a mad rush to try to monetize all the data that's out there. Big data as a driver for value is almost always about human behavior, how to observe, understand, predict, and determine, influence, and shape it in the future. You just need to read, for example, Sandy Pentland's book, Social Physics, look at the Snowden revelations, look at the much more disturbing social credit initiative in China, which is a system for assessing reputation and trustworthiness of every individual, to understand that big data really is personal data. However, a lot of data controllers when they talk to data protection regulators, they try to, their opening gambit is usually to say, well, actually, it's not really personal data that we're really excited about. In fact, only a fraction of what we of the big personal data which is out there is willingly and consciously provided. Most of it is observed. We're carrying around these devices which are usually connected. They are transmitting data all the time. It's usually derived from that observed data. And then it's also inferred. Information is inferred from that raw data, and it's increasingly done by self-learning algorithms and artificial intelligence. And it's interesting, we've noticed that in the last 9 to 12 months, I think largely down to fora like Davos, the debate seems to be moving from big data onto artificial intelligence, and they're in many ways two sides of the same coin. EDPS have had lots of conversations with startups based in Silicon Valley, and it's become quite clear to us that the dominant revenue model is monetizing this personal information. For example, you build an app, and unless you go for the freemium revenue model, you track user behavior, and then you try to sell the data that you've collected and the insights that you've gathered from it. And you can't get venture capitalists interested in your startup unless you have a plan to monetize that personal information. And until now, it's been all about attracting advertisers, mediated by ad platforms. But if you talk to companies who provide advertising services, and they've been lobbying furiously in the last few months because of the e-privacy reform, they're extremely downbeat, very pessimistic about the future. They argue that tech giants are consolidating their dominance over internet ad revenue. And so it may be that advertising may not be the long-term best way of profiting from the contents of the massive data servers which are around the world and known as the cloud. Big companies, in fact, are diversifying into so-called moonshot technologies, emerging industries like life sciences, autonomous cars, biotechnology, AI, and virtual reality. The other interesting thing as we were researching this is that actually big data may not be that new. There was a so-called avalanche of numbers in the 19th century, 1820 to 1840, which followed on from industrialization in Europe. Historian Thomas Richards called this the first information age. It was in fact an analog big data revolution. And the goal back then was the same as it is now. It's a socio-political goal to understand and control the population during a period of significant change. And it continued the previous century's desire to categorize and classify, to catalog and order, to search for rules, and in the 19th century, a particular focus on poverty, crime and health. And now with the, if you like, the digital big data revolution, we call it profiling. The Chinese might call it trustworthiness. But categorization, whether it's as a poor person, a single mother, a black person, unemployed, etc., these aren't just neutral categories. They can be used as a justification for intervention. So the big question is whether big data is it coercive or is it emancipatory? Is it making us more free? Now, going back to data protection, data protection has always been about facilitating data flows according to rules. So the basic idea is that information flowing generates benefits for individuals and society. And so when we talk about big data, we always try to return to that and say, well, if you want big data, then it's the same principles. Facilitate data flows according to rules, but we need to understand who the beneficiaries are supposed to be. Now, on to a few words on the legal framework.
1 minute.
Yes, there are four. We talk a lot about data protection and privacy, but there's actually also the right to freedom of expression and non-discrimination, Articles 11 and 21 of the Charter. Now, all of these four rights, there could be more, are to an extent threatened or undermined by big data practices, and some of those Hans has referred to. So, for example, the lack of the phenomenon of black boxes and walled gardens and now fake news, all of this calls into question whether or not we really have freedom when we're online. So what can be done about it? And I'm concluding now, Rocco, that we have suggested that in addition to having an updated set of rules on data protection and privacy, we need to have coherent enforcement across different agencies. So we're trying to sensitise competition authorities to the long-term impact of mergers, the concentration of market power and data in few hands for consumers and citizens further down the line. We're trying to build alliances with consumer authorities, and we're also trying to bring together privacy engineers and lawyers through the IPIN initiative, which is also on our website, to try to help encourage the EU to create the market conditions for privacy-friendly services and products. The last thing to say on what civil society can do is that we, EDPS, we organise a civil society summit. It will probably be around May or June this year, and we have a blank piece of paper right now. We're waiting for ideas to come in from you, and it's a free event here in Brussels. It will be web streamed, so get in touch with us if you have some ideas about the biggest issues that we need to talk about. Thank you very much. Sorry, I went over time.
Thank you very much. Diego.
Okay. My name is Diego Naranjo. I'm senior policy advisor for EDRI, for European Digital Rights. I work mainly on data protection, privacy, and copyright. And my role within EDRI is try to explain and convince, if I can, policymakers about the implications of technologies, how they affect fundamental rights of citizens, try to prevent those which harm our communities, our societies, and try to defend those which can strengthen us. For example, now we are working on the e-privacy regulation, which is one of the main legal instruments deciding about the online privacy in Europe. And I guess that's our main role, but I go a bit later towards that. And my presentation is based on 3 points. First, the EU policy towards big data. Second, the societal impacts or the risks of big data analytics, and which is our role as civil society. Regarding the EU policies towards big data, I wanted to begin with a quote from Alice in Adventures in Wonderland, which I think is quite applies to the EU. So it goes like this. Would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here, said Alice. That depends a good deal on where you want to go, said the cat. I don't much care where, said Alice. Then it doesn't matter which way you go, said the cat. So long as I get somewhere, Alice added as an explanation. Oh, sure, you're sure to do that, said the cat, if you only walk long enough. This is quite the position of sometimes the EU policymakers towards big data. Vice President Andrus Ansip said the last year, and the famous mantra, the data is the new oil. So the position is basically that, some countries out there are making lots of money with our personal data. So we have to get there. We're not sure why and how to do that. Well, we definitely have to go there. The problem is that big data, the previous speaker has said, is not only more data. It's about creating data from data. Like we could say it's pregnant data, as we usually call it, is that you cannot predict that is being created based on your behavior. And going to the second point on the societal impacts of big data, the issues that the risks about big data, they occur depending on how the model, how the algorithm is designed. For example, we need to see who will be affected about that analysis, which is in the context in which that data is harvested, and how transparent is the model chosen. I wanted to mention 3 environments in which the negative impacts are especially worrying. The first most obvious one is, of course, social networks. We probably all know about the Facebook mood contagious experiment, where they were able to make hundreds of people sadder or happier, depending on what kind of input they put into their timelines. Also, their experiment on the I like button, where they put on their profiles, so that people could were able to put, okay, I went to vote in the American elections. So that created a societal network effect that made people go to vote more often. So this could be used, for example, to make people vote in one or other direction. The second example is about insurance. At the moment, auto insurance tracking methods are usually opt-in, but we can predict that in the future these methods are going to be either you accept this privatized surveillance, or you will be paying more for your insurance, because there won't be enough data about you to quantify your risk, or maybe because those who don't opt in are categorized as a high risk according to the algorithm. The third example, a bit more worrying, is the use of big data in predictive policing. There's a startup called Predpol that produces a software that the police can use to predict where crimes are going to be committed more often within a city. So when you set up the application, you can include violent crimes, which are usually the ones that create the bigger social alert. But you can also include, for example, this called nuisance crimes, which are, for example, petty drug crimes, usually victimless. Nuisance crimes, these petty drug crimes, for example, they affect mostly poor communities. And then the police found that using Predpol, this big data software, was 10 times more efficient than random patrolling and twice as efficient than using police intelligence. However, the other side of the success is of this technology is they increased policing, creates more data. So more people are getting arrested, more people are getting indicted. That reinforces the initial analysis, then leads to more police going to these same communities, which again reinforces the data, which again, so it goes like this in an endless loop that leads to more inequality and to harming our democracies. To my knowledge, no predictive policing has been used on Wall Street criminals. It hasn't been used around the central bank. It hasn't been used in corrupt politicians. So I guess the model depends quite a lot how the outcome is going to be. So in a sense, what these three examples show is that big data models are capable of modifying our feelings, of promoting privatized surveillance, and also to getting more poor people in jail. All of that in an endless loop where the model justifies itself and where the nuisance and social problems are not part of the equation. Big data codifies the past in a sense. So I think we need to try to include values such as solidarity, equality, non-discrimination in these algorithms to create big models that follow our values and not that our policies follow the big data analysis. In order to do this, I believe that big data models need a key element, which is transparency. For example, I'd like to see that every citizen receives an alert when a credit score, any sort of algorithm, is deciding about a crucial aspect of their life. Even more important, we should be able to challenge the analysis and to correct the algorithm if it is wrong. The role of civil society, going to the last part, well, when implementing transparency and also privacy by design, by default, I think we should be the transmitters of real-life implications for citizens of these technologies. We need to be able to connect privacy experts and all sorts of human rights experts with policymakers, but also try to communicate good practices. I think there are a few commented in the BITE report that can be used. Also, I think the issue of profiling and online privacy in relation to big data is getting finally mainstreamed. I've seen news in reports in the Financial Times, in RTTV, which is a Franco-German a famous TV station in The Guardian, but I guess there's more work to be done on awareness. Going back to Alice in Wonderland, I guess we need to figure out where we want to go and build our societies, including our big data models, of course, on bearing in mind the values that we support and the goals we want to achieve. Civil society can help in this process, and we should do so. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, Diego. Estelle.
Thank you. I'm Estelle Massé. I'm senior policy analyst at Access Now, which is an international organization that works for the protection of human rights in the digital era, and we're one of the EDRI members. As Diego, I was asked to explain what should be the role of civil society in the context of the development of big data, and reflect a little bit on the current legal framework and what could be missing, or what, as citizens, could we try to promote. So regarding the role of civil society, there is at least two obvious elements that we're doing through our daily work. The first one is to develop legal standards and technical standards. We've, like many of you here, worked for a very long time to try to ensure that the General Data Protection Regulation would provide for a high level of protection for users across the EU, which includes having rules on big data, on profiling, and reinforcing the data subject rights, such as the right to access your information, the right to object to certain types of processing, including profiling, etc., etc. With the adoption of the law will come the second phase, the more technical one, which was mentioned before, where now that we have a general provision introducing that there is a right to data protection by design, we need to define what does it mean in practice, and what does the industry need to do in order to deliver this promise. And the second part of the role of civil society, which is key to ensure that whatever principles are in the law are delivered, is to raise awareness toward users about those rights and make sure that they exercise the rights, that they know what are the data protection authorities, that they use those records, and that they become aware of what is happening with their data. One of the big issue with profiling and big data is the informational imbalance between the company and the users. It's very difficult for users to know that they're being profiled and that decisions are being made on the basis of this profile. In the context of the legal framework that was adopted, it's difficult to understand how profiling and the practice of making assumption about you by the building of data, adding data, and creating new data is in line with core principle of data protection, such as data minimization and purpose limitation. What exactly is the purpose of the company when they start gathering all of your data to create new one? Do they know from the very beginning what types of results they want to go, and can they define it strictly as required by law? Or are they just randomly trying and guessing and finding something that may or may not be useful or may not be accurate about you? So those are some of the challenges that will come up in the next few years as we try to implement the general framework on data protection. On the societal aspect of big data, we've talked quite a little bit this morning about the fact that big data can indeed lead to discrimination from the profiling. It can prevent you to access health insurance, it can prevent you to access a job, credits, it can prevent you to enter into education. And this underlines one of the big discussion that is a sort of horizontal discussion from big data to artificial intelligence profiling, is that the algorithms that are involved in all of these automated based decisions replicate the bias of our society and are not pure algorithm that makes a completely pure decision. They are inputted with criteria that currently reflects reinforced privileges or promote the elite and arm diversity, as they have the bias that the society currently have, which can be, when they're used in the case of police, as Diego mentioned, it reinforces racism, it can also reinforce inequalities in terms of wages, etc., etc. And a second aspect of big data, which make the problem even harder, is that often the way big data works is conflicting with the way surveillance work, and surveillance also feeds itself from big data. and it's becoming sometimes more and more blurry to see the lines where big data for marketing and big data for surveillance stops and one another, because some of the techniques from surveillance are coming from big data and some of the big data techniques are used for surveillance, which means that the impact on society can be much more difficult to control than what we have now. In that sense and in that context and faced with all the risk, it becomes difficult for users to exercise their right to privacy in the sense it means where it means the right to be left alone. When we're followed by more and more tracking to provide us with so-called better services that we never ask for, how can the users effectively say no and try to prevent possible discrimination? So first we have to raise the awareness about this problem, but then we also have to make sure that people can exercise the right to say no. So in the new framework on the General Data Protection Regulation, users have the possibility to object to profiling. But how does this work in practice if the first step of the awareness and the understanding of how profiling works happens? How can a user technically say no to profiling? That will be one of the challenge that at a technical level, civil society and technologists and protection authorities must engage in order to ensure that this is really happening and that when profiling and big data develop, it does not harm our fundamental right. To conclude on some concrete examples and discussion that are happening where civil society should be more engaged, and I include my own organization in that sense, is that it's true that we put a lot of effort, as been said, on negotiating the general standards, but then this work needs to continue in the awareness raising phase and on the development of the specific technology criteria. So I mentioned the criteria on the right to object. There is also the work on the privacy by design and by default. And there is also some very technical one that have been suggested in the data protection regulation, such as the development of icons to try and help user understand in a more easy way what is happening with their data. So there is suggestion to add icons about whether your data is being sold, whether it's being sold to third party, whether it's being reused, et cetera, to try improve the awareness of user on their use of data. So we have a lot of work ahead still in order to make sure that the framework that was adopted is fully efficient in promoting the right. It's definitely a great step in the first direction. And in the sort of lawmaking debate in Brussels, we also have a new challenge coming, as Diego mentioned, with the e-privacy to specify those rules within the context of communication, where the use of big data, in particular metadata for big data, is also one of the big challenges. And I'll leave it there for the moment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You all kept this time. Actually, you left more time than expected. So I will start with the first round of questions from the audience or participant, actually.
A little bit louder.
I would like to push back a bit on the transparency angle that is being pushed, because in a lot of civil society debates, they always say, oh, if we just make the process transparent, it will become better. And I think we have to have a more nuanced understanding from this, because A, it comes from the assumption that transparency leads to accountability, which is highly questionable in the first place. And B, it also leads to the assumption that we can actually understand the process once we make it transparent. And I actually think that these are very crucial factors to keep in our back of our minds when we call for transparency. Because just by making computer programs transparent doesn't mean we understand it. We still don't understand what decisions are based on it, so it's a very complex process. And I think two weeks ago, Kate Crawford actually released a very interesting paper about 10 points why transparency doesn't work. So I recommend reading that every time before you make this transparency thing, because I think it's very complicated. Like, even the big data companies don't understand how their algorithms work. So how do you expect people outside these companies to understand them in the first place? So I recommend that. And then also thinking that transparency actually doesn't always lead to accountability. Kate Crawford.
Yeah. Thank you. A rejoinder on this kind of topic of transparency, you're not obliged. Just if there is an immediate reaction. Okay.
I would like to suggest one place where I think there will be an opportunity for civil society mobilization. And it builds on what you said, Diego, about pricing and insurance. You know, I think it's almost axiomatic that individuals will get mobilized when they see something affecting their wallet. And so I think the uses of big data for differential price discrimination will probably get more engagement from citizens than some of the other kinds of discrimination. And in most places, price discrimination is completely legal. So it doesn't raise an issue, but there are certain industries, certain services where price discrimination is currently illegal. Those are the common carriers, both for transportation and communications, who are required to have the same price tariff for everyone. The Airline Trade Association has already adopted a resolution setting a goal of personalized pricing, breaking away from being common carriers so that they can employ big data for price discrimination legally. There is going to be a struggle. We've seen the first round of that in the US. The airlines were almost successful, but not quite. We're going to see it worldwide. This is a global goal. So I think one of the touch points for civil society engagement is when service providers start going to government regulators asking to be freed from common carrier rules to engage in big data-based price discrimination, and people can see that it's going to cost them. And that's a place where, again, it doesn't matter that the rules are transparent. It doesn't help you if you know that the airline, if they see on your Facebook page that your mother is dying, they can charge you 2,000 euros to fly to Madrid today because they know you'll pay any price. It's a coming fight that we're going to see on this, I think. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I'll take another comment or question, please.
Okay. I wanted to connect this topic of profiling, particularly also with the old topic of data retention and telecommunication, because we know, we see, especially in Austria, again, even though we made the complaint from there, also together with Digital Rights Ireland, we came to the court, and even in Austria, where our constitutional court, after it abandoned it, we discuss again about data retention, as in many other countries. On the same side, we see in the matter of profiling for credit scoring that we have a data retention, a huge data retention, just as a matter of fact there. So since many years, all these scoring institutions and so on, they do two things. They have, first of all, the identity data. They are the more serious identity provider, usually, than any state authorities. We see on the same time also that public authorities, I saw in the context of the UN Special Rapporteur on Privacy of Joe Kanatachi, a project from United Kingdom for predictive policing, a big data project that is already running, and they get their set of information data from a private company, from a private identity provider, which is of course also a scoring provider. So what I would like to suggest on really a European level is that we try to connect these discussions, because the data retention, the traffic data retention discussion, telecommunication, it's extremely hard to make people understanding, to raise awareness. And so we did the job in Austria, we brought 100,000 people for a parliamentary petition. It was a huge work, and it is not so much space. If we connect these two topics, if we talk about data retention, not anymore just in telecommunication, but we connect it and make the people aware, there is a permanent retention of all your scoring, of your not just creditworthiness, trustworthiness, almost like in China, we have that as a matter of fact, maybe we can activate more people in their awareness.
Jeff Chester, Center for Digital Democracy, and that does remind me that one way of addressing this, which partly is self-serving, being from the United States, is this, that to put a highlight on the role of the US companies operating in Europe, because the data companies are certainly the digital marketing platforms, but the identity providers like Neustar, exactly what you talked about, okay, Axiom, they're all working here. What the US companies have been able to do, despite your direction, is to expand its footprint and business model here, which has affected the entire way that Europe has operated in terms of profiling and digital marketing. And of course, the Privacy Shield, of which you guys and Max, you know, is a joke. And I think just focusing, even the price discrimination system, which is deployed already, right, is now being, you know, it's gearing up, as you say, absolutely, you know, is part of this. So looking at the role of the U.S. companies and their practices and showing how, in fact, that violates everything Europe stands for is perhaps is one way of raising public awareness. Now we can blame it on Trump. It's even better than blaming it on Obama, who didn't say anything either.
Thank you. I'd like to collect some reaction from the panel, if you feel so. Don't feel obliged.
Well, yeah, I mean, I completely agree that transparency is not a silver bullet. It's part of the solution, because these companies need to be honest about what they're doing. They need to be honest with regulators, otherwise regulators can't regulate. But the danger with transparency, too much emphasis on transparency, is that you put the burden on the individual to understand what's going on and make rational decisions. Instead, under data protection rules, the burden is on the controller. So if you choose to process personal information, it's your responsibility to do it according to the rules. And we have now lots of court judgments saying they need to yes, their business interest is perfectly legitimate. But if it's a competition between the business interest and the rights of the individual, the rights of the individual almost always win. So price discrimination we've been thinking about as well, because in our dialogue with competition authorities, we wonder whether price discrimination itself is the right term. It's more sort of unfair discrimination in terms of the rights framework that we have. I mean, companies will always try to differentiate and maximise profits, but what we see further down the line, and there's some really good scholarship on this coming out of Ario Israki in Oxford, is that if machines are able to collude in the market to ensure perfect price discrimination, then all of the value goes to the companies who own those machines, and none of it goes to the consumer. That's a kind of dystopian possibility, but it's a perfectly credible one. And then the last thing on data retention, yes, I mean, we need to hold all companies to account for their data retention policies under the new General Data Protection Regulation, which has clear rules on how long you should keep data for. It's not just about telecoms.
To add maybe on the accountability part, which is the key part. How do we get there? How do we get companies to be accountable and to respect our rights? We have this issue, at least in the EU level lawmaking, that the two of the institutions that are supposed to make those companies accountable are also not accountable to us. So a lot of the discussion in the European Commission or in the Council are not accountable to the citizen, then we end up with a framework like the Privacy Shield or with the data retention regulation from 2006 that was negotiated in 6 months. And discussion right now that despite the ruling from December 21st that there might be a new proposal on data retention, even though the court is each time trying to clarify when I meant no data retention, I really meant no data retention. So how do we get to bring the companies accountable when the institutions that are supposed to bring this accountability are also not accountable to us? So there is a larger crisis here that needs to be addressed. There is some part of the Commission that are more sympathetic to the work we're doing, as well as the European Parliament. But there is a need, and in this current time, the need is higher to make our leaders also understand that this accountability means respect for our fundamental rights and our democratic values, and everything is interlinked. So if we try to show that all of our work links to a much bigger work and everything relates, because we're facing a lot of challenge in digital rights, but we're not the only communities that are facing challenge. There is setbacks on environmental policy and social policy. So there might be also ways in the near future to also discuss with other groups on how they work and how they try to tackle this general accountability challenge, where we can hold companies accountable, not not to limit them and not to limit business practices, but to make sure that when business practices are in place in Europe, they are taking place according to the fundamental right that must be respected.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, on the transparency and accountability issue, I agree with the critique on a sort of naive notion of transparency. But on the other hand, I think it's important to use that element from the data protection framework, because a lot of the principles, they all are a bit above the head of the data subject, and it's the transparency angle which gives you a data subject a way into what's done. If I look now how the sort of research, what's happening on privacy by design, there's a lot of work going on anonymity, on things which more or less come out of the data security angle, but when it comes to transparency, it's quite weak. And in a way, I think there is a lot of work to be done on useful transparency and how that it indeed can be turned into accountability. And that's something which will have to be put also on the research agenda by civil society, because it's not going to come out of the industry. If I look to, for example, the transparency practice of Google, it's a very interesting thing to see. In a way, it shows it's possible for a big data company to really give access on the individual. In fact, what's the useful element for companies of big data can be turned around for, let's say, the data subjects. But at this moment, is the company deciding what the transparency means? You get transparency to your data, but what happens with that data, where it flows to, who all the other actors getting impact on it, you don't see anything on that. So in there's a lot, a big gap where civil society can step in to make sure that transparency can get indeed become some sort of useful accountability tool.
I'm also very sensitive to the question of transparency. I think that is a very good remark. I think that is a little bit misleading also, because it gives us a little bit the idea that all these systems are very solid and are never fragile, which we know is not the case. We know that many algorithms needs to be twisted all the time to keep functioning, and that many big data systems actually need a lot of labor to keep working and running as we expect them to run and work when we criticize them. And so I think that this transparency presupposes too much of a smooth functioning of the technical system, which is not always the case.
I feel the need to respond, because I guess I brought the issue of transparency.
And then you're silent.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have 10 minutes presentation. I can discuss about everything, or I can focus on one topic. I decided to focus on one, which I said is not the main topic. I didn't say it's the main issue. I didn't say it was the only issue. I said it's one key issue. Second, I think transparency is sometimes very useful. And for example, if I know how this predictive policing works, I can react to it. I can go to the courts, I can go to civil society, I can go to a consumer rights organization, I can go anywhere, complain, go to court, and try to bring that down. Sometimes this transparency is useless, and I agree with you. If they give me the maps of this building, so I can be sure this building will not collapse now that it's full of people, I don't have the skills to know if that is true or not. So I have to rely on experts. I guess in this case, the work of the EDPS and the DPH is crucial. So we have the expertise and the passionate people on board that can assure me as a non-technical person, or relatively non-technical person, that's going to happen. So yeah, it's not the main issue, but it's one that I wanted to bring, so Estelle could bring the accountability on board. So yeah, I agree with you. It's not the only issue.
There is a short rejoinder.
Yeah. Okay, I don't want to be the Debbie Downer.
But louder. If you want to be, you have to be louder.
But I just want to say two things. One was funny, because you mentioned the Google Transparency Report, and I saw some civil society eyes roll, because in civil society, this is known as sort of a smokescreen. But the predictive policing is actually quite interesting, because there is the human rights data analysis group, they did they sort of recreated one of the predictive policing algorithms, and there's a great talk about this on Data and Society. It took a computer scientist 7 months to rebuild this algorithm, fix the problems that was in the code, and then run an sort of neutral data set that was not related to the police data sets, and showed sort of a feedback loop, a negative feedback loop, how certain groups in society keep on being negatively reinforced as more likely to be criminals, and in this case it was in America, so they were African Americans. And it's a very interesting talk about how these algorithms, if they are made transparent, you can do something with it, but it took a computer scientist 7 months to recreate this algorithm. So, and then there's still a lot of ifs and buts around it. And then also becomes an interesting point, because this is somebody outside the community who has been marginalized, because it is known in America that African Americans are targeted more by police than white Caucasian people. And yet there is no accountability to that, or little accountability to it. And actually this recreation of the algorithm also, it's interesting, she talks about the academic conferences, but in the end very little also happens with it. And the police forces still use this algorithm because it's a commercial proprietary software that they bought. So I think actually the Google transparency is not such an interesting example, but I actually do think that this talk by Christina Loom from this human rights group is really interesting, how they tackled the problem. If you don't have access to everything, how you can still make it transparent.
So I think what is being said is that that those systems are too complex to be transparent, to be made transparent. So maybe the solution to this is to have a rule that in some cases, in some certain situations, there is a maximum level of complexity in a system. In other words, to translate this to a very practical rule, the government, for example, should always be able to explain how they came to a certain decision. If the algorithm is too complex for the government to be able to explain it, then they shouldn't use it. In other words, have some kind of a upper level on complexity in a system. If it's too complex, you can't explain it, so don't use it.
I think that there are golden rules in computer science about what a beautiful algorithm should look like, but about the fact that you should be in principle able to redo by hand, which like calculate. But I'm not an expert in that. I'll be curious to see if. Know that there is all in the statics of algorithms and rules about what a good algorithm should look like, because not all the algorithms are the same, even if they have the same purpose. There were a couple of there, and then I'll come back to you, don't worry.
I just want to add a small remark that complexity is not only in the algorithms, but also in the data. So it's kind of split things, so I think from technical point of view.
And can I ask you to elaborate for the public or for the rest of the part, what do you mean complexity in the data? An example.
Well, you're going to have a very simple algorithm that works on a very complex data. So you can explain how decisions were made, but to explain it, you need to reveal the other data, which is quite huge anyway. And also, it's not only it's the two points of the two sides of the coin, the data and the algorithm.
I'd like all the panelists actually to come back to the question of the complexity of the data, but we'll come back first.
I wonder if on the transparency debate we have two different angles to think about and how we can use them in civil society, because the technical aspect of transparency is different from the policy. And for example, right now in England, you know, we've been working on trying to get transparency around policy where education data collected in schools has been used in immigration enforcement, and that was in secret. And now in the States, the commission, there's a commission looking at whether a federal clearinghouse should be created for creating government and administrative data sharing. Now, we should be using that kind of information in the case study we've got in transparency in England to take that to the States and say, right, given your politics, these are the real harms that can come about from that data sharing. And how can we, in civil society, use those commonalities that we can learn from each other? How can we be horizon scanning? I would like to see some channels for us to be able to do that better together, where big data is crossing boundaries and policy is perhaps universal, and we have commonalities in different countries. How can we bring that horizon scanning experiences and transparency from one place to help each other in civil society in different locations?
Okay, we have some other questions, sir.
Please.
Yeah, sorry, not so much a question. Actually, I think it's really interesting the idea of limiting the complexity of the system you use. The risk you run is that the decision has to be made in some way, right? Like a lot of this is automation of stuff that was otherwise being decided by people. So if a decision has to be made and you limit the complexity, you may end up in a situation where people will say, it's not worth it, we're gonna go back to using human judgment, which obviously has flaws, and then they're gonna say, why did you make this decision? Well, because I did. I'm the person empowered to do it, and that's the answer, and too bad, go away. So you have to think about some of the transparency measure is also in adding insight into how a decision is made at all, rather than human judgment as the alternative. So you can't just say, these are things, well, let's look, compare one computer system to another. You have to think about what the real alternative is if you limit the use of this technology at all, and then build from there to create the accountability that suits best. Right, the accountability is definitely a good thing, and this provides an opportunity to respond to sort of the fundamental problem of human judgment being retroactive and illogical from the beginning.
One opinion to transparency. In combination with the GDPR, I think that we have a better right for transparency, and this combined with the new penalties that are coming with 4% of turnover of the companies, they get an awareness of potential financial problem what they have, and it helps companies to raise at least awareness for this problem and to have a minimum maturity level of thinking about what they are doing with the data. So also, as you say, transparency is not the complete answer. At least it helps for a minimum level in the wider range of all companies.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I will just like to shift then the thing and say if transparency is not the ultimate weapon, if transparency should be differentiated between technical transparency and policy transparency, what else is left?
Well, this gets close to something that's been worrying me for a while, which is there are essentially two kinds of dialogues. One is a dialogue that's rooted in some sense of human rights, so the collection, reuse, whatever, is a violation of a right not to be tracked, or freedom of expression, or self-realization, whatever it might be. And the other is a sort of a technocratic cost-benefit analysis, which is pretty much the debate you're limited to if you speak to a government agency in the United States, at any rate. And particularly in the second category, but I think perhaps in both, big data is resistant to the kinds of arguments we've tended to make in privacy issues in the past couple decades, partly because its benefits are, by definition, unknown. And therefore, measuring both costs and especially benefits is extremely difficult. So when one takes a technocratic, when one speaks to someone with a technocratic mindset, they say, yes, we want to collect on to see all the great things we might get. And in a sense, it's impossible in a cost-benefit way to say, well, look, here are the costs. They say, yes, but the benefits might be bigger, we don't know, you know. And so that discussion doesn't even get off the ground. Now, so I think in going forward, we need to have tools, not just on the human rights side, but also on the technocratic side, or come up with a third middle strata, but I'm not very optimistic that we'll get moral rights in data or anything like that. So it's depressing.
Okay, give me a bit more of a boost. It's still the morning. Sure.
A couple of things that ought to be said. I don't think we should look for silver bullets. I don't think we should look for silver bullets. We should look for things that might be useful in a piecemeal way, perhaps. And it occurred to me to wonder whether it
might a bit louder.
It occurred to me to wonder whether it might be possible to think about moving towards some kind of standards for transparency. What would good transparency look like? You know, there's a whole scale of lousy transparency, bullshit transparency, all the way up to being very good. And is there any traction in trying to get that up to scale and get that more accepted? The second thing to mention is that we're in an age now of deep skepticism of experts. And when we talk about having the expertise, we're in a dilemma because we want to have the expertise to understand algorithms and all of the rest of it, then experts are now easy game to be discredited as, oh, well, you guys are just experts and therefore ineffective and we don't want to hear from you. So that may be a difficulty for even very well-intentioned civil society groups who rely upon that kind of expertise. How does that play in the public? And the third thing I want to mention is that even though transparency doesn't necessarily lead to accountability, we have to interrogate what we mean by accountability, who should be accountable to whom, and what would be the mechanisms of accountability, the machinery, the institutions for accountability. It's not good enough to say, well, they should be accountable to the people, to society, and so forth. But what are the specific mechanisms through which accountability can be realized? And what do we expect an account to look like? What is an account? Because that's the heart of the term accountability, is an account. An account is a story about what a company has done with anybody's data. How can we know whether to believe that story? To whom does that story have to be given? And how can we have pushback to investigate the veracity of that account? These are all dilemmas. I have no solutions. But the big words, transparency, accountability, and so forth, need to be unpacked in terms of the precise mechanisms by which they can be made more effective.
I think that there is something interesting for our panelists here about the role of or the relation of civil society, but also institutions with expertise. Because as we were mentioning, big data is also about epistemology. So probably there is a third dialogue that has not really started yet, that is the one about the kind of form of knowledge we want to create with big data. And there can be very different use of big data and knowledge generation. Like I'm an academic, and bibliometrics are a form of big data, or big data before big data. So what's your relationship with different form of expertise? Because like Google's slogan at the beginning was that data speak by themselves, so we actually step out. It's mechanical objectivity, as a French researcher tried to say. So what's your relation to expertise, and what's your role in expertise about big data? How do you see it?
Well, I mean, you mentioned regulators, and they need to up their game. Like, data protection authorities have a lot more powers. That you mentioned the fines and the sanctions. That with that power comes responsibility, and they need to be more. Well, the states need to give them sufficient resources to and independence in order to be able to carry out their role under the charter, but they also need to have technical expertise, which they don't necessarily have had in historically, about how the technology is working, about how to interrogate an algorithm, to distinguish between whether the problem is biased within the algorithm or the problem is the data set, as also has been mentioned. I think another point, which may also respond to what you were saying about the situation in the US, is the language that we use is often not very helpful for ordinary people. I mean, most people don't talk about rights and laws. They talk about, you know, whether or not they're being left alone, or whether they're able to free to do something or not. And I think there's something that regulators and also civil society could perhaps do more in order to connect in the language that we use, and looking at, you know, the harms that can occur, not necessarily through just using data, but the accumulation of data. In the US, they think it's okay to accumulate as much data as you want and then regulate how it's used. But I think we'll start to see now that, you know, building up these enormous volumes of data contained within them risks, which will start to become more. People will become more sensitive to those risks.
Thank you. Only a few of you.
Well, very briefly, I think that we should, and we are incorporating experts to our networks. One of the best examples that I know within EDRI is in Privacy International. They have a great IT experts that translate the problems of citizens to policymakers, or to us, to policy people like me. So they are capable of seeing the loopholes in the systems and translate that into problems that everyone can understand, and then from that we can translate that into problems for policymakers. There are many other ED members that have not only technical expertise but also legal expertise, which is also very, very necessary. So, and I'm glad to say that I'm in a very big network of experts. And yeah, well, in briefly, that's our role: translating problems, translating technical issues into problems of citizens.
Thank you very much. Do you want to say some concluding remarks or wrapping up or making the point? Or
now, in the debate we had here, there was a lot about transparency and accountability and what it all this means. For me, this is one of the sort of discussions I think is very important also to do as civil society and try to feed in whatever comes out of that debate into policy discussions, because it's exactly the fact that those notions are still so unclear that we have to give it more substance. And it's a job we as a civil society will have to do. We can't leave it to an industry or even to academics, which also more or less react based on outside signals. So in this sense, for me, this is really where civil society has to organize itself a bit and to get that, to find the channels to feed it in. To conclude, one of the reasons to do this panel for us was with BITE. We tried to form a sort of big data community, and so it's an invitation to NGOs to become part of it. It's more or less focused on the EU policy, also on research, on the Horizon 2020 agenda. It's connected to the Big Data Value Association, which gives input on that research agenda, but which is now mostly a technical community of industry people, of academics from the technical side, and there's a clear demand also from the Big Data Value Association, from all actors, that more stakeholders get involved, to also to make sure that sort of questions get addressed. So in that sense, it's an invitation. If on the presence list, wherever it landed, you put yourself on the email list, you can get more information about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I sense that we are very close to our coffee break. I have good news. Internet will be there after your coffee break, but don't start downloading movies or watching movies. Keep looking at the speakers. And do not connect unless you need it. And you'll decide your own needs in terms of internet connection, but keep it low. It's a limited, scarce resource today. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much to all of you.